Oh, where we are today with the gender rights. We are not in the most comfortable situation right now. There's lots of efforts to take back the rights of people in many places, and this is not only in Poland. As we see, it's also happening in the United States. And after what happened with Roe versus Wade, we can expect that also LGBT rights will be under attack next time. So it's a very specific situation for human rights, defenders, for democracy as such. Something unprecedented is happening right now. And this is a massive attack that was well planned, is organized, is well financed, and it's not really representing the people, because as we see the polls in the United States, as the polls in Poland, they show that people are more progressive than the laws that are created, which is quite peculiar.
I would dare to say that's very interesting in comparison with what pride communities in Western Europe used to be, especially when they were in their infancy in the 60s and the 70s, these pride communities in the West, is that indeed gender expression and gender identity takes a much more visible role at this moment. And the fight for LGBTIQ plus equality in Central and Eastern Europe. I was last weeks at several prides in Sofia, Bulgaria, and several prides in Poland. Next week, I'm going to be in Hungary. And every time I am in one of these more Central Eastern European prides, at one of these post-communist prides, let's put it like that, you see a lot more flags. It's not just a rainbow flag. It's for sure also the progressive rainbow flag, but much more the non-binary flag, the LGBTQ straight ally flag, the all kinds of sexuality flags and so on. So you see that especially young people take a lot more pride in identifying themselves within a specific, I hate to say the word, but within a specific category within the spectrum of gender identity and gender expression at this moment in Central and Eastern Europe, something that you see much more in Central Eastern Europe than in Western Europe still, because prides in Western Europe are still very rainbowy, but that's the main flag you see still. While in Central and Eastern Europe, it's actually the opposite. You see a lot of different kind of flags. So people take a lot more effort and a lot more pride in identifying themselves within one of the specific categories of gender, of the spectrum of gender diversity and sexual diversity.
So I think, first of all, I hope by now everyone knows that gender is not biology. That is not to say biology doesn't exist, which is why you also have the term sex to refer to these biological differences, such as sexual characteristics. But really, these biological differences don't explain the reality of our world. They don't explain what it actually means to be a woman or a man or a non-binary person, for that matter. And that's why we have this word gender, to refer to the socially constituted roles, behaviors, expressions, and identities of men, women, and gender diverse people. And what I think is really critical to understand is that gender is not some kind of trendy thing. It's not a trendy identity issue. Gender is really constitutive of our very world, of everyone's world, whether man, woman, trans, non-binary. Professor of anthropology Anne Whitehead has stated this quite beautifully, saying gender is never absent. And what that means is we cannot escape our gender. Gender is always there. And particularly for women, this is the case. You're always perceived as a woman, always subjected to stereotypes, implicitly always inferior to man. And a good example of this is street harassment. So basically women's objectification when simply walking down the street. But even women who make it are subjected to these social norms, these social stereotypes. Think of the ways we talk about female world leaders, such as Jacinda Ardern or Angela Merkel. The fact that they are women always needs to be commented on. It's never only about their leadership or abilities. So gender is never absent. It's always there in the social space. And actually, the oppression of gender diverse people stems from this ever presence of gender in our world. Gender is never absent. So then sort of these ambiguities in gender form a problem. We want to establish whether the person we're talking to is a man or a woman. And if we can't categorize them, we don't know how to treat them. And this sort of presence of your own social identity that you cannot escape is really something that other oppressed people share as well. It also applies for race, for example. Race is never absent either. Then when it comes to gender equality, I think it's really important to point out that the problem is not women and their position and status. And when it comes to gender diverse people or trans people, the problem is not trans people and their position and status. It's really the relations between the different genders. The problem is between, for example, men and women, and then also trans people, non-binary people. It's about the social relations. You can't separate what is expected from you as a woman in a certain society from what is expected from men. And ultimately, this is about power, really. Who holds the power to make decisions? Who holds privilege? And when it comes to gender equality, nothing will change if we do not address underlying power imbalances.